We're going to talk today about the sin of indifference. You know, the Lord has given me many, many messages, and as I say, they bring me to my knees, things that I haven't seen and yet things that I personally have been guilty of. And I just can hardly handle it sometimes that when I realize all that I personally have done, didn't mean to, but when you begin to see things through the eyes of Jesus, things change. He does not see things the way we see them. He doesn't interpret things the way we see them. But when he begins to talk to you and give you some insights, everything begins to change. We're going to start today. I'm going to read to you first about indifference. Let me tell you what indifference means. It's the lack of interest, care, concern, or sympathy, unimportant, neither like it nor dislike it, just nonchalant about everything, neither hot nor cold, no opinion about it, apathetic about things, don't give a rip about anything really, one way or the other. You're just lukewarm. I don't have an opinion. I don't really care. Let's go to Luke chapter 12, verse 42. Luke chapter 12, from the New American Standard Version. And the Lord said, "Who then is the faithful and sensible servant?" Now, we've read these, but I want you to read it in a different little light. Pay attention. "Who then is the faithful and sensible servant whom his master will put in charge of his servants?" Now, notice he said he's asking who's faithful and sensible. You got to keep those words in mind. And the master will put in, that person will be put in charge of his servants to give them their rations at the proper time. "Blessed is that slave or servant whom his master finds so doing when he comes." Doing what? Being faithful and having some sense. That's not exactly the way the Lord said it, but that's my interpretation. "So truly I say to you that he will put him in charge of all his possessions. But if that slave, that servant, says in his heart, 'My master will be a long time in coming,' and begins to beat the slaves, both men and women, or beat the servants, both men and women, and to eat and drink and get drunk, the master of that slave, that servant, will come on a day when he does not expect him, and at an hour he does not know, and will cut him in pieces and assign him a place with the unbelievers. And that slave who knew his master's will, that servant who knew his master's will, and did not get ready or act in accord with his will receive many lashes. But the one who did not know it and committed deeds worthy of a flogging will receive but few. From everyone who has been given much, much will be required. And to whom they entrusted much, of him they will ask all the more." Now, I've read that so many times, but it just hit me in an entirely different way. Now, the key to this week's message is the bottom of that right there, when it says, "From everyone who has, to everyone who has been given much, much will be required." All of us, everyone here, everyone watching, no matter where you might be, at your house, your home, in your car, sitting wherever you may be sitting, there's not anybody who calls themselves disciples of the Lord or Christians. There's not anyone. If we were to sit down and we were to write a summary, a continuous summary of all the good things that God has done for us, it would fill pages upon pages upon pages of the goodness of God. Especially if you look back over your lives and you journey back through all the goodness of God that he's done for you and all the craziness that you've done, the times that we said so many times that we walked away from him, that we acted like he wasn't aware of what we were doing, or that when we went in these crazy places and did these crazy things, that God wasn't anywhere around. We're so dumb. God is everywhere. And then when we're born again, he comes and lives inside of us. And I'm not, you know, we act like when we get born again, we all do right. You know, we don't. And whatever we're doing, we're bringing God in the middle of it. You see, the hand of God has been protecting you and me all these years from our foolishness. My goodness gracious. Blessing you right in the middle of all your immaturity. Blessing you in all your craziness. Blessing you when you absolutely just did wrong no matter what. I mean, you just did it. Like me, just made your own, I don't want to do that, I'm going to do it this way. And God in His mercy would help us, guide us. And, you know, he just, it's amazing to me how God has put up with us. If I were God, I wouldn't have put up with me. And thank God God put up with me. That's all I can say. How about you? Can you say the same thing? Thank God God put up with you. Oh, thank God. So His goodness has indeed, we could say, run after us. You know, that poem, The Hound of Heaven, so many years I've read it and thought about it. He just hounds us. He just comes after us. God does not want to do us in. See, hell was not made for us. So God does not throw people into hell. God has never sent anyone to hell. He does not send, you know, His people, or He does not send mankind to hell, even those who turn away from Him. I mean, we send ourselves to hell. So, you know, what we're down here, it's a decision time. We're here to make decisions. We're here to decide who we're going to follow. You say, well, I'm not following anybody. I don't believe in God, and I don't believe in the devil. Well, whoopee-doo, one day you will. One day you will. And the one that you've served, you'll meet face to face. That's for sure. But God in His mercy is so good for those of us who through the years have asked God into our lives and we've walked away and we've done this and we've done that and we've done the other. He's just so good to us, and I praise Him with everything in me. Even when we don't get what we think we want, He's still good. He's good to withhold it because He knows if we got it too early, we'd mess it up. So all of us have to learn things, glory to God. Now, you know, the Lord doesn't keep things from us. He keeps things for us. Now think about that. He doesn't keep anything from you. He keeps things for you because He knows what's best. Father really does know best. He knows what's best for you. God gives and gives and gives again. But that He also, and this is where we have messed up, He requires something in return. And we've overlooked that. He never said to him who is successful that He's going to give all these things to. Let's look at what the Father really says. Let's go to Matthew 25:21. Let's look at what He says. His master, 25:21 says, His master said to him, well done, good and faithful slave, servant. I keep quoting it because depending on what translation, and it's really servant. You were faithful with a few things. I'll put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. Then look at Luke 16:10. He who is faithful in a very little thing is faithful also in much. Now that's interesting. If you go be faithful in something little, the indication is you would probably be faithful in much. But if you're not faithful in little things, you won't probably be faithful in much. So that tells us why we will not be moving from one area to another. He who is unrighteous in a very little thing is unrighteous also in much. Let's look at Luke 16:12. And if you have not been faithful in the use of that which is another's, who will give you that which is your own? Now, I've seen many a person, that's a scripture that'll hit you. Many a person will say, I don't know why God hadn't done this, why He hadn't promoted me, why He hadn't done this, why He hadn't done other. Well, that scripture right there answers for a lot of people. For a lot of people. You go to work and you work for somebody else and you do this, but you are not faithful. You don't care of. You're not faithful to what somebody else is. So why in the world, what makes you think that God's going to give you all this stuff yourself? You don't have to live very long before you realize that there's no such thing as getting something for nothing. Let me help you understand this. I've seen so many people not understanding one single thing about who they are, understanding their value, understand that they were sent here for a reason by God, understand that God has something particularly for them, and God has a divine destiny, has something with your name written on it that means for you to do this, and you were sent here. No one can do what you were sent to do. No one. You came with a divine purpose, and only Jesus can reveal that to you. Well, no one ever told me anything like that. But when I began to see who He is and how He saved me from a journey to hell, how He saved me from my, in itself that ends up taking you there, how He saved me from self, and how even going to the cross made it so that sin that dwells in my flesh, we learned this last week, that the sin that dwells in my flesh, that the power of it, Jesus broke. And that He set me, I'm the person on the inside, you know, with spirit, soul, and body. You know, I am a spirit. I have a soul, my mind, my will, my emotions, and I live in a body. And Jesus came and renewed me, rebirthed me, meaning my spirit man, so that I'm made in the image of the Lord God Almighty. And then Jesus and the Holy Spirit moved inside of me. And so sin cannot entangle me, meaning me as a person, me as who I am in Christ Jesus. But sin does dwell in the flesh. And so if I have not learned to control my flesh by any means, then I could be born again, filled with Jesus, and stifled. Stifle what I mean? Stifling the Lord in me so that my flesh has ruled so long until it becomes such a habit that my flesh automatically leads me toward to do sinful things, because that's where sin dwells. And so I end up thinking I can't help myself. God brought back to us and made available to us a vision He gave me in 1996 pertaining to sheets, linens. And I would see emaciated people lying on a bed, and then they would be lying on the Word, on a sheet like this, on a linen like this, be lying on the Word, covered over with the Word, and then they would spring, and their head laying on the Word, and then they would spring up as they released their faith, totally healed. It was absolutely amazing. It covers your entire bed. So you're sleeping on the Word of God. You're going to be covered over, because the design is on the flat sheet, on all of it. So you're going to be covered over with the Word of God, and then you're going to lay your head upon the Word of God, and you're going to release your faith. And you're going to, because they've already been anointed with oil and prayed over, but you learn to release your faith. And as you release your faith, God intervened. It's just a way to release your faith. There's nothing funny about it. It is the Word of God Almighty and a vision of 24 years ago that we are now being able to complete. The twins are 165, the full are 209, the queens are 220, and the kings are 236. You give them as a gift. Do anything you can to spread the gospel and get the Word in somebody's face and let them know God is not a man that He should lie. He said that by the stripes of Jesus, you and I are healed. Not we were, but we are healed. And remember when He said, I sent my Word and healed you. And then praise Him for sending things that you and I can release our faith on. He's a miracle-working God. If you've never given your life to Him, please open your heart and invite Jesus into your life. You need to know Him, because there's a heaven to gain and a hell to shun. And Jesus has heaven prepared for you, and He will take care of you even while you're still down here. He's such a precious God. He loves you. He really, 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 really loves you. And He's coming back, as I said, very, very soon. Now, turn with me to Matthew 13. beginning at verse 10. Matthew 13, let's look at it again. The disciples came and said to Jesus, why do you speak to them in parables? Jesus answered them, to you it's been granted to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it has not been granted. For whoever has, to him more shall be given, and he will have an abundance, but whoever does not have, even what he has shall be taken away from him. Therefore I speak to them in parables. This is Jesus talking. Therefore I speak to them in parables, because while seeing, they don't see. While hearing, they don't hear, nor do they understand. In their case, the prophecy of Isaiah is being fulfilled, which says, you will keep on hearing, but you will not understand. You will keep on seeing, but you will not perceive. For the heart of this people, grab this, the heart of this people has become dull. With their ears, they scarcely hear, and they have closed their eyes. Otherwise, they would see with their eyes, hear with their ears, and understand with their heart, and return, and I would heal them. Now, let me put this in context so that you and I can really get it. This was a crowd of Jews that Jesus was talking to, a people with a very rich heritage in God, like us. Those of us who've been listening to the Word of God all our lives, we live in America. Most of us have been in church. I mean, we've heard Sunday school, everything. Rich heritage in God. They knew all about Noah. They knew all about the flood. They knew all about Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They knew how God had delivered their forefathers. They knew all of that from slavery. And they celebrated every year God giving of the Torah, God Almighty delivering the Torah in the hands of Moses on Mount Sinai. So they had this history. They understood. They knew what the prophets had foretold. They were well aware of the writings of Isaiah and Jeremiah and Hosea and Amos. Those were absolutely household names to the people that Jesus was talking to. Yet the Lord said their hearts had become dull. In other words, this is not affecting you anymore. In other words, they'd been taught, and what they had been taught had become uninteresting, boring, uninspiring, and unmotivating. That's indifference. They were what we would call lukewarm or backslidden. The principle of sacrifice has been lost to them. It says in another place that they didn't gather to truly learn how to live for God. They gathered for what they could get from Jesus. Now that's so obvious. All you have to do is just look what Jesus did for all of them. All you have to do is just pay attention. The thousands upon the thousands who were here, there, and yonder. And yet, when it came down to the bottom line, they just went to get food. They went to get this. They went to see all the things that this man could do. Wow! I mean, it's like going to the circus. Hallelujah. I mean, this is like going to some kind of show. Let's see what he's going to do now. But it did not matter. When he was in a tight place, when he needed their support, where in the world were they? Doing their thing again. That's where they were. See, sacrifice means that you give more than is required. In the Old Testament times, sacrifice was not about a dove or a lamb presented at the temple. Matter of fact, God gives a definition of sacrifice in Psalm 51, if they'll put that up right now. Psalm 51. We can see that definition. Verses 16 and 17. For you do not delight in sacrifice. Talking about the Lord now. Lord, you don't delight in sacrifice, otherwise I'd give it. This is David talking. You are not pleased with burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart. Oh God, you will not despise. A broken and contrite heart and a broken spirit. somebody who says, oh dear God, it's me standing in need of prayer. It's not my brother, it's not my sister, it's not you. I'm not justifying my behavior. Dear God, it is me. I am wrong. Do something in me. I don't want to get up from here unless I am changed and rearranged. That's a broken and contrite heart. I don't ever want to be that way again. See, it's always been about the heart. Walking with God is always about the heart. Their heart had become dull, so they had to disqualify themselves, listen up, from receiving revelation from the lips of the Son of God in the flesh. I could put it this way. They were indifferent to the teachings of Jesus. They heard them. They lied. I mean, man, nobody's ever taught like this, they said. I mean, nobody's ever taught like this. But it didn't do anything. They listened and went home and said, wow, nobody's ever taught like that. But, oh, praise God. You know, where we're going, what we're going to do now, what's up? It didn't do anything to them. Turn back to Matthew 11. Let's go to Matthew 11, starting with verse 20. Then he began to denounce the cities in which most of his miracles, this one is going to really rock your boat. This rocked my boat. Then he began to denounce the cities in which most of his miracles were done because they did not repent. Woe to you, Chorazin. Woe to you, Bethsaida. For if the miracles had occurred in Tyre and Sidon, which occurred in you, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. Nevertheless, I say to you, look at this. It will be more tolerable for Tyre and Sidon in the day of judgment than for you. Wow. And you, Capernaum, will not be exalted to heaven, will you? You will descend to Hades. For if the miracles had occurred in Sodom, which occurred in you, it would have remained to this day. What would have remained? Sodom would have remained. Nevertheless, I say to you that it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom in the day of judgment than for you. Whew. Now, my goodness gracious. Listen to this. You need to understand something. The opposite of gratitude is not ingratitude. The opposite of gratitude is indifference. Indifference. These three cities saw the power of God, heard the word of God. They refused to repent and change. Chorazin, Bethsaida, and Capernaum. All the things that happened there did not change the cities. Did not. They didn't criticize Jesus. They just ignored him. They didn't come against him. They just ignored him. They listened to his preaching. They witnessed his miracles. But they went on with their personal lives with business as usual. Man, I have certainly seen that. Haven't you? I've done that. Have you? I have. I mean, confession is good for the soul. Lord, have mercy. They did not change. They were unaffected by all he had done in their midst for them. They acted as if they've never heard or the miracles never happened. The brother of the Lord said it this way. Look at James. This is how James said it. James said, for if anyone is a hearer of the word and is not a doer, he is like a man who looks at his natural face in a mirror. For once he has looked at himself and gone away, he has immediately forgotten what kind of person he was. My goodness. Let me make sure you really get this. What he's saying, Jesus said it would be more tolerable for pagan, idolatrous cities in the day of judgment than for those who had heard his word and experienced his miracles and yet became indifferent, lukewarm, dull in spirit. I hope y'all are still listening. Laodicea had the same problem, if you remember. Great teaching, prayer meetings, good leaders. Yet it says in Revelation, they were neither hot, they were neither cold. Lukewarm, lukewarm is indifferent. If you've heard the word so long that it no longer shakes you or rattles you, if it's so familiar that we fail to let it penetrate to those areas of our souls that Jesus so desperately wants to change for us, we are in danger of being and living in indifference. We have the Word of God. We've been taught and taught and taught and taught and taught. It's not the knowledge of the Word, but the application of the Word that God is looking for in us. Not how much you know, how much you do based on what you know. We're responsible for what we know. And the Bible says, to him who knows what to do and does not do it, to him it is sin. That's James 4:17. To know what the word says and yet say of your pet sin, it's no big deal. God's merciful. My friend, it's the sin of indifference. And the sin of indifference is deeply offensive to God. Oh, God, forgive me when I've walked those ways. Forgive us. Here's the other insidious thing about indifference. The devil loves to lure you into it, especially in these end days. He'll tell you, you're doing fine, don't be radical. Your preacher's radical, don't be radical. You know, you just expect her to say those kind of things, but you can look around and read signs your own self, don't be radical. Don't ever forget that not all thoughts, you need to remember this, that not all thoughts that go through your mind are your thoughts. Your eternal position in the heavenly realm will be a direct reflection of your faithfulness here today. To whom much is given, much is required. I hope you learned something. I hope it ministered to you.